Excuse me, Mrs. Beethoven.
Call me Janet.
I'm the new director of catering for Julius Mainland Food Emporium. I understand you have specific needs.
Right. As you know, I'm doing most of the composing these days because, not to put too fine a point on it, my husband's elevator doesn't go all the way to the top.
I'm not sure I understand.
His buttons don't light up when you touch them, you know?
I'm still confused.
So is he. Main thing is, I need to eat certain foods to write music. Those things with the chocolate squiggles, I need more of those. This is the kind of idea I get when I'm eating those. Bum 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 bum.
That's really uplifting.
You bet your Austrian hiney it is, but this stuff? What is that? Fish paste or something?
Well, sort of. It's a traditional dish. That's...
Never mind, it doesn't matter. Do you know what kind of music I wrote after eating that crap? Today is gonna be the day that they're gonna throw it back to you.
Wow. That is just horrible.
I know. In 200 years, it's not going to sound any better. So just to review, bring me food that makes me write sublime music. Don't bring me food that makes me compose garbage. Comprende?
I just never knew it worked that way.
Well, it does. The whole key to composing is to eat the right food and stay away from prostitutes! I wish I'd warned you-know-who about that a little earlier in our marriage. Anyway, today we're focusing totally on the food part of that equation. And now he was Peter Frampton's private chef, Colin McEnroe.
That's right. Once again, we visit the interesting world of Janet Beethoven, the otherwise undiscovered wife of Ludwig von Beethoven. Anyway, enough about Janet. We're here to talk about gastromusicology. And so what we're going to do is talk initially... And I should say our guest here for the first two segments is Ira Braus, an associate professor of music history at the Hartt School, and he is the author of Classical Cooks, subtitled A Gastrohistory of Western Music. And we're going to talk first about something that you probably do, which is to occasionally use the language of food to talk about music, and the sensations and the feelings of food are probably closely paired to your perception of music. So we'll talk a little bit about that in the beginning, and also about how composers themselves did the same thing, right? You'll see. And then in the second segment, we're going to talk about the whole notion that maybe actually even changes in their diet, what they actually ate. A lot of these guys had, and it's pretty much guys, as we know, but a lot of these guys had pretty fixed diet ideas, or pretty elaborate or eccentric or extreme ideas about what and how much to eat and drink, as you might imagine. Anyway, joining us now, as I say, is Ira Braus. So let's just plunge right into it. This is the way you want to set this up beyond what I did. You know, maybe the best thing to do is give a good example, and we could even give an example within one family in terms of J.B.S. Bach versus...
Carl Philipp Emanuel.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you for inviting me onto the show, Colin. And I want to say, just to preface my remarks, is that talking about classical music, especially for non-musicians, can be rather daunting, especially if the music doesn't have words like opera. There are, of course, symphonies and sonatas and chamber music pieces. And as a professor of music at the Hartt School and somebody who's done some adult education courses on music appreciation, I find that one way of making classical music very visceral, literally visceral for listeners is to compare it to food. And one of the reasons is that the composers themselves did this. To give you an example, I want to start with a rather familiar name, Bach, but not Johann Sebastian Bach, his son Carl Philipp Emanuel, who incidentally celebrated in one form or another his 300th birthday last year. And Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach, besides being an extraordinary composer, was a very important writer on musical subjects. And around 1753, he wrote a treatise called Essay on the True Manner of Keyboard Playing, which was a combination music theory and music practice book. And one of the issues that he treated in this book was ornamentation. That is to say, taking a simple melody and instead of playing one note after the other, adorning it with little curlicues that we call trills or mordants and that sort of thing. And it turned out that he was trained by his father, who was one of the great representatives of Baroque music, which is a very highly ornate music. And as much as he admired his father's music, he said, I really can't follow that path. I want music that's a lot more direct, that speaks to the heart. That's actually a phrase that he used. And if you read his essay on ornamentation, he writes the following. Above all things, a prodigal use of embellishments must be avoided. Regard them as spices which may ruin the best dish, or gewgaws which may deface the most perfect building. Now, what does that mean in musical terms? Well, let's hear an example of highly ornate or highly spicy music. And this is the music of the generation that preceded him, the music of his father, and even more so the music of the French Baroque. And if you think about, say, the architecture of Versailles, you think about the way the people dressed at Louis the 14th court with all their various jewels and ornaments and so on, you can hear it in the music. We're going to hear just a little bit of a piece by François Couperin, who was probably the most important composer of Baroque keyboard music. And this is the type of music that Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach wanted to get away with, which is just a little bit of a...
Oh, so that's what you want to start with, the Couperin?
Couperin, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So that'll be, I think that's A3 in there. You got that? Okay, here we go.
Yeah. Okay, now you hear that practically every single note had a little gigaw on it, a little bit of spice. Okay, now... C.P. Bach, when he was writing music, wanted music that was really direct, speaking from the heart. And this is his idea of expressive music.
So this would be, I think, A2, Wolfie, we're going to hear the sonata in A minor.
A minor, slow movement of the A minor sonata. Okay.
So that's not spicy. That's
not spicy at all. Just one note after the other. And,
right.
and the pianist is singing from. That's Glenn Gould, who liked to sing when he was playing, as a matter of fact. Okay, so this is one example. Now, another way why this type of approach to music, gastromusicology, as I call it, is a way that it can show connections between composers, very often from different periods. And I'd like to jump now to the music of Carl Philipp's father, Johann Sebastian Bach, and the music of a composer named Johannes Brahms, who was considered to be probably the foremost symphonic composer of the late 19th century in Germany. Now, these two composers came from entirely different periods, but they had a lot in common. And I want to just read you a little story about Johann Sebastian Bach and Brahms that kind of ties this up very nicely. This is one of the reminiscences of Brahms's friends. Once while dining out with friends, Brahms called to the waiter, "Give us a good bottle of wine, but it must be your best." In a few minutes, the man returned with a bottle cradled in a basket, a venerable affair covered with spider webs. "What sort is that?" demanded Brahms. The waiter inclined himself obsequiously. "It is a bottle of Brahms." But at once the master, tapping it and pushing it away, cried, "Well then, give us a bottle of Bach." Well, what did he mean by that? Well, lots of things. First thing is that Brahms was a very, very humble composer, and he was very historically conscious of the composers who preceded him, among them J.S. Bach. But more important, he was born in 1833 and died in 1897. He lived during most of the part of the 19th century. And just a few years before he was born, another composer named Felix Mendelssohn had pretty much brought J.S. Bach's music to light because it had been pretty much in hibernation for the previous 80 years for reasons we won't go into here. But at that point, when J.S. Bach's music was revealed to Europeans, especially the Germans, he became kind of a national hero, kind of an icon. And composers as different as Brahms, Wagner, Liszt, Schumann absolutely worshipped him, okay? So that's one thing. The second thing, which is probably more interesting and more important, is that Brahms was involved in making Bach's music very popular. He was a choral conductor. He was probably the first conductor in about 100 years who performed Bach's cantatas publicly. He was a choral conductor in Vienna. And he also edited Bach's music for the new complete edition of Bach's music. And more important, he took one of Bach's pieces as a model for his last symphony, composed about 1885. Now, let's listen to those two pieces. I want to talk a little bit. I want you to listen.
You want to start with the Brahms or
start
with
the Bach?
Start with the Bach.
Okay.
So that, we have a jukebox in there, so put a quarter in there and play A1.
Okay. Now,
just so we have time.
Okay, yeah. Okay, well, if you listen to the rest of the piece, you would hear that this entire movement is based on a chaconne structure, which means that there's a rising bass line, which just keeps on repeating about 20 or 30 times, and the upper voices become more and more elaborate. It's almost like a blues type of structure, right? We have the same chord progression, just recycling, and the soloists, you know, draw melodies out of that. Well, in 1885, Brahms took that bass line, and he made it the melody of a chaconne in the last movement of his fourth symphony. So we'll listen to that.
All right. Yeah. B2 in the jukebox. Wrong one. Right. Maybe right. B1. B1.
Yes, that's it. Yeah. Okay, and again, if you listen to the whole movement, you would hear just a series of variations using the same principle that Bach did. One other thing I should call your attention to in terms of sort of culinary connections between these two composers is that if you read accounts of their food ways, you'll find that they both had this really strong desire for herring. They loved herring. In my book, I talk about the fact that Johann Sebastian's second wife, Maria Magdalena, wrote that her husband loved herring more than any other fish. And the reason for that was that when he was a young boy, as students of music may recall, he took something like a 150-mile hike from a little town in central Germany to Hamburg to hear a great organist. And he sustained himself just by eating herring and herring heads.
And Brahms became quite corpulent as his life went on.
Oh,
right?
Definitely, yes. Yeah. So he had a lot of herring.
He had a lot of herring.
Too much herring, right.
All right, we need to sort of grab a break here. But as we go into the break, just sort of once again embrace that idea of composers themselves using the language of food to talk about their compositions. Mm-hmm. We've got a piece by Ligeti. This is a harpsichord piece called Continuum, which he describes as chopping salami, right?
Yeah. The exact words.
It really sounds like 10 knives chopping 10 salami.
It says the sound would consist of innumerable slices of salami.
Yeah. Innumerable is the key word here. Here we go. We're back. This is our Gastromusicology show. After this segment, we'll take a short break for fundraising. Do, by the way, participate in the fundraising, particularly if you love our show. Helps our show if you, in fact, make a pledge during the pledge break. Then we're going to come back at the end. We're going to be talking about an unusual patent that attempts to link the notes of the scale to the notes in food, probably for the purpose of manipulating us to buy more Frito-Lay products. But anyway, that's coming up. Ira Braus are with me right now, Associate Professor of Music History at the Hartt School. His book is Classical Cooks. It's about this very notion of the linkage between food and the work of classical composers. These composers, I mean, they did eat all kinds of different diets. Satie ate white food. He had this whole idea that you should eat food that doesn't have any color in it, right?
Yeah.
And do you feel as though you can sense in the spareness of Satie that, I mean, do you feel like you can draw a straight line from that diet to that music?
Oh, very much so. In fact, if you look at Satie's plainness, you might say his whiteness in his music, you can see it almost as a kind of self-conscious reaction to this Wagnerism that was sort of overtaking French music and composers. And I have a wonderful letter from him to his friend Claude Debussy, which actually addresses that. He said, I explained, or actually a memoir he wrote. He said, I explained to Debussy the necessity for a Frenchman to disengage himself from the Wagnerian adventure, which does not correspond to our natural aspirations. Just a little footnote here. Many of the French composers of the late 19th century were absolutely hypnotized by Wagner and made pilgrimage to Bayreuth and so on to hear Wagner's music. And you can hear in Debussy's music, in his opera, for example, Pelléas and Mélisande, a lot of Wagnerian overtones. But by the end of the 19th century, I think a lot of the French composers were getting tired of this, as this this letter or this reminiscence expresses. I'll continue. He says, and I pointed out to Debussy, that I was by no means anti-Wagnerian, but that it was necessary for us to have a music of our own with no sauerkraut, if possible.
Ah, no sauerkraut. So yeah. We're going to hear one of the Gymnopédies. But when we do that, think of going into Satie's refrigerator, where you're going to find white stuff. You're going to find rice. I think he ate like crushed bone, and there were camphor and weird things, did all kinds of weird things to food to make it even more white. Yeah. And then, like everybody else, he drank too much, died of cirrhosis. But he boiled his wine, right? Who knows why he did that? All right. Yeah. So here's what you sound like. I mean, I love Satie, but here's what you sound like when you eat too much white food.
You know, Colin, we might contrast that with eating too much sauerkraut. Mm. And we could listen to the beginning of Wagner's Prelude to Tristan, where practically like every single note of the scale is fermented, or chromatic, as we say.
All right, so here's Wagner, who, by the way, occasionally tried to be a vegetarian, but apparently wasn't very good at it.
No, he wasn't.
He would eat like rabbits and stuff like that, right. And then he'd become a vegetarian again. All right. So we're going to hear the Wagner. Oh, sorry.
Beginning of. No, that's not. No, sorry. That's not it.
All right.
Oh, go to the beginning of it.
Oh, I don't know if we have the beginning of it. We've got what we've got here.
Okay.
All right.
It's chromatic enough. Okay.
So Ira Braus, some of these composers loved food, and some of them are more indifferent to them. I mean, Rossini, not only does he have things named after him, actual dishes named after him, but he was famously an enjoyer of food.
Yeah.
Stravinsky, famously
a
guy who really loved food, right?
Right.
I mean, some of these guys are really, I guess even we were talking this morning on the Where We Live about Virgil Thompson in your book. Mm-hmm. Virgil would like eat more than three meals a day, right?
Right.
Do you think that sort of shows up? Is the sensuality that is the Firebird connected to Stravinsky's love of fiery couscous?
Well, it could be. Sometimes, you can't make direct connections like this. But I think there's in some cases when the composers actually do use imagery and metaphors like C.P. Bach, talking about spice and so on, you can make a direct connection to this. But I would like to go back to that playlet that Wolfie did at the very beginning, where she was talking about Beethoven's wife's use of food as an aphrodisiac. There's a section in my book where Wagner talks about food as direct inspiration for his composition Tristan and Isolde. Mm-hmm. And I won't read this here because it's rather lengthy, but he was writing a letter to Matilda von Weisendonck, who was the inspiration of Tristan and Isolde, and said that he got to a certain point in the opera where things just didn't click. He had sort of writer's block. But he said that he had some special Zwieback, this sort of dry German toast, delivered to his workplace. And he started eating. He said, this is what freed all of my compositional creativity. Zwieback, the savior of composers, that sort of thing.
Are there instances where you can see a change in individual? I mean, we're talking about composers kind of, over the course of their lives, but within the course of a composer's life, are there times where the composer's diet changes and then the music changes?
Oh, yes, that's a very good question. We don't have any musical examples here for this, but I think the best example of that is Beethoven. because if you read the accounts of his friends, his young friends, they said that all Beethoven ate was macaroni and cheese 4 or 5 times a day. You know, how can anybody survive on that? But Beethoven did. He was very poor when he came to Vienna in the early 1790s. But the longer he remained in Vienna, the more famous he became and the more affluent he became, because his students ended up being, say, members of the Austrian nobility, such as the Archduke Rudolf and so on. And when he became that prosperous, he started eating like the Austrian nobility, which in that time was eating meals that maybe had four or five courses with 4 or 5 different meat dishes. And we know about this because if you read Beethoven's conversation books, these are the books that he used towards the end of his life to communicate with people because he couldn't hear anybody. And he has orders to the cooks where he lists 5 or 6 different types of meat, and he says no spices, which is kind of interesting because this sort of carries on the C.P.E. Bach tradition, which a composer whom Beethoven very much admired. And sometimes when I teach I teach a string quartet class at the Hartt School, and I emphasize to students, because we read early and late string quartets of Beethoven, that the early string quartets are very, very peppy. They're very starchy, like macaroni and cheese. And they're usually just in 4 movements. They're rather relatively succinct pieces. We look at the late string quartets. They very often have 5, 6, 7 movements. You might think, corresponding to the 5 or 6 courses, in the diet of an Austrian nobleman. And they're very, very dense. You might say that they're like meat protein, because every single measure, has some version of the theme which is being developed or permuted in some way. And I think that there may be, a cause and effect there. Of course, we can't go back and examine Beethoven's metabolism. But I think it's more than coincidental that this change in diet, along with other factors, really can explain to a certain extent this very radical change in concept.
I mean, the interesting point, too, that a lot of these composers wound up eating food that wasn't natural for them. Chopin longed for the rest of his life for Polish food because he was living in all these fancier European capitals like Vienna, where the cuisine was more sophisticated in a way. But give me that old Polish country food, I don't get anymore. Yeah. Well, we've got enough time, I think, to make a contrast that you make between Debussy and Ravel. Debussy, we'll start, is a more sort of continental fancy. He's actually a cook, right?
Yes. Yeah. Debussy was a wonderful cook, and there are all sorts of accounts of his cooking. I'll just see if I can find one here. Let's see now. Here we go. Okay. This is from his friend Satie again. This is his remembrance of, memoir of meals with Debussy. He said, "Among my memories as a guest, I cannot forget the delightful lunches I had over several years with him when he was living on the Rue Cardinet. Eggs and lamb cutlets were the center of these friendly occasions. But what eggs and what cutlets? I'm still licking my cheeks on the inside, as you can guess." Debussy, who prepared these eggs and cutlets himself, had the secret of this preparation. The whole ensemble was washed down with delicious white Bordeaux, whose effects were touching. And so on.
Well, let's hear just to sort of work that out a little bit.
Yeah.
Let's hear Debussy's from Trois Nocturnes, one segment from that. Okay.
Okay. Well, people sometimes have trouble distinguishing him from a composer named Maurice Ravel, who lived about the same time. These two are commonly known as Impressionist composers, but they inhabited entirely different worlds despite certain superficial similarities. And there's a wonderful reminiscence of Ravel as a cook by a friend named Ricardo Vignes. And he says, Debussy and Ravel were both Sybarites and devoted gourmets. Debussy was perhaps the less voracious of the two, whereas Ravel distinguished himself by consuming alarming doses of pickles, pepper, mustard, and other stimulating condiments, which he was able to stomach, and by his marked preference for exotic and oriental dishes. And what I like to tell people is that when you listen to Ravel's music, as opposed to what we just heard before, the spiciness, the dissonance is a lot more pronounced. And a good example of that is a piece called Alborado del Grazioso. It's an orchestra piece.
All right, so before we play that, let me just say we'll be heading from there probably into some fundraising. We've been talking to Ira Braus. His book is Classical Cooks. Yeah. And it sounds a little bit like, you know, if you're going to Paris now, Debussy eats on the right bank and Ravel eats on the left bank.
Yeah,
you know,
it
goes to the ethnic restaurants in the Latin Quarter.
Exactly.
Fiery, spicy things.
Yeah.
And anyway, so coming up after this, and please do participate in the fundraising. It's very good, very helpful for our show. We'll be talking about a different kind of gastromusicology, the actual attempt in modernity to link notes of the scale to foods that we eat, probably for the purpose of getting us to either enjoy those foods a lot more or ideally getting us to buy those foods a lot more. So anyway, we're going to end this segment with the spicy left bank Ravel.
Domino's? Yeah, I'd like a medium cheeseburger stuffed crust pizza and Mozart's piano concerto number 18 in B-flat major, Kirkel 456. And can you hold the mozzarella and the minor key second movement? Thank you. Today's show was produced by Lydia Brown and me, Kyone Wolf. Greg Hill appeared in the intro and tweets for us at WNPR Colin. The part of Bill Curry was played by the Flying Burrito Brothers. For show pages, articles, and MP3s of the Faith Middleton Show staff performing Sweet for Caramelized Onions and Truffle Oil in B minor, visit our website, WNPR.org. On tomorrow's show, the changing face of Jewish identity. And now, back to Colin.
For our final installment here in this episode about gastromusicology, obviously, you know, we'd have to have Mark Abrams here for this. Mark Abrams is the editor of the Annals of Improbable Research. He's the organizer and I believe the MC of the Ig Nobel Prizes. His books include Why Chickens Prefer Beautiful Humans and Sex as a Heap of Malfunctioning Rubble. I just want to say, Mark, that in the 1980s, I wrote a book called Swimming Chickens and Other Half-Breasted Accounts of the Animal World and a book called Lose Weight Through Great Sex with Celebrities. So I feel
as...
I feel like we are blood brothers, really. Yeah. We've both written books that have chickens and sex in the titles.
That seems to be the center of the universe at certain times.
Everything is a chicken. I feel it's mildly unfair to have you on this show today because I'm really going to be asking you to explain research for which you should bear no responsibility.
Oh, I bear no responsibility for almost anything I talk about. I talk about other people's things.
You know, when I thought about it a little more, I thought, yes, there's no reason to apologize for this. That's kind of what Mark does.
But it's a kind thought.
Yeah.
Thank you for that.
But I am going to oblige you to explain something which I find inexplicable, and you may not be able to explain it either because it's not your research. But you did write about this this patent, which involves corn chips, song, and the internet. This is a method for sequencing flavors with an auditory phrase. Let me sketch out my absolutely spotty and space-filled understanding of this, and then you can ideally enlarge it. So it seems to me what we're talking about here is somebody seeking a patent in order to marry what we sometimes refer to as flavor notes, but I don't think we ever meant them as musical notations before, but the tastes of cilantro or tomatillo or salt or whatever, and actual notes, as in musical notes in a scale, that it might be possible somehow to link the experience of eating certain kinds of food, not just in a Pavlovian way, but in a way that really, in fact, reflected the similarity between food flavors or food eating experiences and listening to music. How close am I coming to your understanding of this?
That's my understanding of it, too. That's pretty much the way that the inventor describes it. And the inventor didn't just seek a patent, but success was his or hers. In year 2011, U.S. patent number 794311. I'm saying his or her because it's a name not familiar to me. The inventor is named Eapen George. First name Eapen is spelled E-A-P-E-N. Do you have any experience with that?
I have no experience with Eapen.
So Mr. or Ms. George got this patent and assigned the rights to it to the Frito-Lay Corporation of North America.
So we know right away that, putatively anyway, the people who might be most interested in exploit. I mean, and I think this is a patent that is meant to a certain degree to exploit us, right? To, I mean, maybe it's a patent meant to enhance our enjoyment of Frito-Lay products. Let's go with that benign explanation first, and then we can go with the sinister one afterwards. So the benign explanation, I'm assuming, Mark, would be that I would buy some Frito-Lay product, and some Doritos or some this or some that. And the way that I understand it, I think from your coverage, is there might even be a little barcode thing on the bag where I could point my phone, and if I had the right app or something like that, it would even tell me the music that I was going to fuse with my Frito-Lay consuming experience.
That's pretty much what they describe in this patent. Now, I don't know how often you see patents, or when I'm saying you, I mean you, whoever is listening, as well as you, to whom I am speaking directly, and you are speaking back to me. But these patents are long and detailed, and they tend to vary as you, if you read through them, between being perfectly clear and lucid and completely full of jargon and intentionally mystifying stuff, because they don't want competitors to quite be able to get all the details. And in this thing, they describe what you described. They produced at least one commercial that apparently got on the air. It's on YouTube. You can look it up. And it's the singing group, the hip-hop group, the Black Eyed Peas, sampling some Doritos while some music plays that's supposed to be enhancing, I guess would be the word, the so-called flavor notes. In the patent, they do talk about that dual definition, that two-sided use of the word note. Musical note, of course, everybody knows, but here they describe at quite some length how a flavor note to flavor professionals, the people who try to concoct the flavors that are going to be in foods that will be sold, it can be something distinctive. And they're trying in this to commercially marry these two different definitions of flavor.
So, yeah, the patent says music, such as can be expressed in an auditory phrase, is a powerful part of a human's sensory experience, triggering emotions, feelings, and the recall of emotion, of memories. And yet no effort has been made, and here lies the shame, that's my editorial comment, no effort has been made to correlate and link a tasting experience with a relevant musical sequence, such that the flavor notes of a food product complement the musical aspects of an auditory phrase. Consequently, a need exists for sequencing the flavor notes of a food with corresponding auditory experience. So,
you caught that phrase too. A need exists.
A crying need.
To me, that is the most moving, most musical bit of the patent, that phrase, a need exists. You can almost hear it singing off the page, not just written on the page.
Right. I think, Mark, when you and I think about it, when we think about moments where we've felt a vague, unspecified emptiness in our lives, we now know what that emptiness was.
Yeah, it's that we didn't see the Doritos commercial, and more than that, we didn't hear it while we were seeing it.
Well,
can I read you a couple of phrases
from
this
patent? Yes, please do.
It's highly intellectual, let's say. It says, the flavor produced by coconut or cheese lingers much longer than a volatile oil compound, thus providing what's analogous to a base note of long duration. Ginger can be considered a transition flavor that provides a clear demarcation between one flavor and another, or a transition note. And it goes on to kind of bounce back and forth between using this word note as if it's talking about little bits of flavor that gradually or suddenly hit your mouth and the notes that you're hearing from the instruments. It's a almost psychedelic experience reading this.
So, Mark Abrams, when we think about that incredible gulf, that that vacuum in our lives, that really amounted to not simply the absence of the proper Doritos commercial, but really as we sit down to our meals of coconut and cheese and ginger, we had until now no idea what music we might put on. If we went over to our music library, what would we put on that would enhance and complement this experience? We just didn't know, you know? I mean, we were
ignorant. We were beasts.
We're blundering around in the dark. So, I mean, this patent holder is offering to instruct us, to in fact develop some kind of guidelines. But obviously these wouldn't be guidelines, because it's a patent, that would be necessarily shared with any yokel to do as he or she pleases. The initial plan is to share this with Frito-Lay and then have us get an app and then we point it at the bag and all this stuff.
It's possible that the inventor, Eben George, was and is an employee of Frito-Lay. That's a pretty typical thing in these patents, that the inventor will be listed as a person, but the rights to it are for the company that the person works for. I'm not sure on that. And also reading this, there are a couple of things. One is sometimes these patents are slightly misleading. They want to have enough information that the rights to it are protected for the inventor, but it's misleading in a way that somebody else, some competitor, might try to do this thing but end up with disaster because they couldn't quite get the gist of it. The other thing is, when you read this, you get the invention that Eben George, be Eben he or she, is the first and only person to do this kind of thing. And that's not so. There are a bunch of other food scientists, they usually call themselves, in different parts of the world, who've been doing similar things for a long time. One of them I'm pretty familiar with is a professor at Oxford University in England named Charles Spence. He has been doing experiments for years of trying to marry together all the different senses and see what happens when you say, one of his famous experiments is to have somebody take one single bite of a potato chip while listening to the sound of that bite passing through some electronics and being modified so that the high-frequency notes are removed or extra-low-frequency notes are added or things, to try to see if you change the sound of what you're hearing as you bite, does that drastically change what you think you're tasting? And what they found was that was true. They could, with a potato chip, they found that by doing this, they could completely manipulate whether somebody thought that that potato chip was fresh and crisp or old and soggy just by changing the sound of it.
Yeah, and I think this is probably especially true for the chip family of products. I mean, it might not be quite as true for broccoli or something, but I mean, it makes a certain amount of sense.
Maybe fresh broccoli, though.
Could be. Al dente.
Well, or crispy fried broccoli.
There you go. The possibilities are endless. Then the question becomes, you know, as we ask from time to time in Spider-Man comics and elsewhere, what if this information were to fall into the wrong hands? Although it could be argued, since Frito-Lay already has it, that it is in the wrong hands. But setting that aside for a moment, it's one thing, obviously, to try to figure out what the actual musical notes are that correspond to flavor notes. So let's decide that eating a cool ranch Dorito chip, if there is such a thing, that, you know, experiencing the lime and the cilantro and the whatever else there is, that really we're experiencing a musical pattern that goes da ba ba bum bum ba 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 ba. Now we're eating more and more chips. Ba 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 bum. So that's fine. And maybe
I have a feeling you didn't pick those notes at random.
Well, I picked notes that everybody would know, all right? So now we know that maybe while we're eating these chips, we'll enjoy them even more, we'll intensify the experience if we listen to the soundtrack to Close Encounters of the Third Kind, or whatever that is. So that's great. But then what Frito-Lay really wants, Mark, I would think, would be under certain circumstances, like if we're, you know, walking into a convenience store, to play that music, and then we walk out with six bags of this stuff.
It could. Of course, it's always or often dangerous to try to assume you know what's in the mind of another person, especially if that person is a corporation.
Right.
And
yeah, give me an example.
As you were just saying, I was looking at the patent, and there's a little passage in there that sounds almost like what you were saying. It's becoming eerie how much you're understanding what they're about. It says in the patent, the person composing the auditory phrase can be, in one embodiment of the patent, professional musician or composer. Alternatively, the auditory phrase can be composed by an amateur. Sharing the auditory phrases composed for specific products with the general public enhances the tasting experience for the food product involved.
Well, that also sounds like sort of user-generated content. Like, ultimately, their goal is to get us to create content that can be used to manipulate us, right? That we'll post up.
So you're suggesting this is really about getting us to do their marketing for them.
Totally, and that's what they'll do. They'll have a contest connected to the Super Bowl saying, write the best song that approximates your experience of eating Cool Ranch Doritos, and the winner will get to, I don't know, go shake hands with Peyton Manning or something. And basically what will happen is one of us members of the Common Rock, will be writing music that can be used to manipulate the human race.
And probably not being paid any royalties.
No, probably not. I mean, I have a very dark vision of the world, so feel free.
I can see and almost taste that.
Yeah. Feel free to correct me. Feel free to say, oh, no, I'm sure it's not.
No, I feel I'm getting a good education here talking with you. I'm grateful for this opportunity.
Yeah. Always inspect the dice is what I say. Well, you know, it's interesting. We contacted you because of your writing about this particular study. And we've been doing this show about gastromusicology where we're talking about the relationship between music and food, and in our prior segments, we've talked a little bit about the food that great composers ate and how it may have actually changed the way that they composed.
Well, in some cases, it killed them.
Or killed them. That's the other choice. And by the way, we've been talking to Mark Abrams here. He is the editor of the Annals of Improbable Research and the organizer of the Ig Nobel Prizes, and is the author of books that have the titles involving both sex and chickens, a distinction that we share together. As we end today, we will play that Black Eyed Peas Doritos commercial, and everybody will get up from wherever they're sitting and go and get Doritos because the era of thought control has begun, yes?
Damn, you're making me hungry now.
All right. Let's end then with the Black Eyed Peas. Thanks very much, Mark Abrams. Thanks to Lydia Brown and Kion Wolf. And here we go. Get ready to crunch.
Good to see you.
Are you ready for the flavor trip, Peas? I'm going to take you through a flavor journey. In the past, you get one flavor on a chip. Now, you get four notes coming, one after the other, that take you through this melody in the mouth. Are you ready for a flavor trip? Are you ready?
Let's go.
Ready.
Let's go.
You'll be tasting distinctively four notes, one after the other. You are listening to the taste, and you're tasting the music.
Same chip, man. It came with some crazy little flipperies on my taste buds.
Garçon, what's in this pasta fajoule?
Garlic, onion, carrot, tomatoes, cannelli beans, and Haydn's Cello Concerto No. 4 in D.
You fool! Don't you realize everybody is allergic to Haydn?